Members, good morning. This is already the appointed time and we formed a quorum. May I call the meeting to order? Information papers issued since the last meeting. Please note that we have received 6 in total and they can be found on the first item of the agenda. If there are no questions, then the second item is this, the agenda for the next meeting. Please refer to paper 268-18-1901, list of outstanding items for discussion, and also the list of follow-up items under 02. On the 13th of November, the chairman and the deputy chairman has a meeting with representative of the Bureau on the work plan for this year. So the Secretariat has already updated papers 268-18-1901 and 02, and they've been issued to members for information. So please note the proposed timing for discussion will depend on the final plan of the government, and we will adjust it depending on the readiness on the part of the administration. The next meeting is scheduled for the 1st of February 2019 at 8:30. The proposal from the administration is progress update of the construction of the Shatin to Central Link and also progress update of upgrade of signaling system for railway lines. Do members agree that this should be the two items for our next meeting? Ms. Tanya Chen, so you just said that it would be a CSL and also another item. I'd like to know whether the XLL will continue to be a standing item on our agenda, or will progress be given in due course? Well, I think they will only give us an update when it is appropriate, because if we have three items every time, we won't have enough time for that. I suggest that the administration gives us either quarterly or written reports so that we can understand the progress of the project. All right, Secretary, please relate this to the administration. All right, do we have further views on the agenda for the next meeting? If not, then we go on to the matters arising from our meeting dated 29th of October. We have to vote on 7 motions proposed at that meeting. And may I remind members that Mr. Lau Kwok Fan has decided to withdraw motion number 5 because the time is already passed for that motion. All right, we're going to vote on Mr. Michael Tian's motion. Can you please ring the bell? Mr. Michael Tian has yet to arrive. All right, we cannot deal with his motion. Then the next motion by Mr. Jeremy Tam again. He is not yet here. Item 3, Mr. Lam Cheuk-ting. Luckily, I'm here. I move the following motion. Under the service arrangement, service performance arrangement penalty system, now the time for calculating the penalty is the longest delay of train when train service is maintained at a limited level. I think this cannot fully reflect the impact of a service disruption on the public. So I think we should include factors such as the total length of delay and then also the number of commuters affected into the system. Thank you. We'll now vote on this. Please start to ring the division bell. All right, voting begins. Have we all voted? If all members have voted, Mr. Lo Wai Kwok, what were you saying? All right, please check your votes. Voting is closed. Display the results, please. 10 for, 0 against, 1 abstention. The motion is carried. Now we deal with motion number 4 from Mr. Gary Fan. Again, he is not here. Motion number 5 has been withdrawn by Mr. Lau Kwok Fan. And the motion 6, also Mr. Lau Kwok Fan, have we projected the motion onto the screen? Do you want to read it out? I don't think it's necessary. All right, can we vote on the motion, please? We'll start the voting. Have we all voted? If all members have voted, please check your votes. And then voting is closed. I display the results. 8 for, none against, 1 abstention. The motion is carried. And then we will deal with motion 7. Mr. Au Nok Kin. Yes, I would like to read it now. This subcommittee expresses regret for the administration's inability to coordinate in the service disruption of the MTR dated the 16th of October. The Transport Bureau should review whether its ETCC is operating effectively, and then it should publish is action list for all lines of the MTR in case of a service disruption, and it should also review whether the current FAM service performance arrangement is really sufficient. We'll now vote on this motion. The results are 10 for, 0 against, 0 abstention. So the motion is carried. So we have completed all the motions outstanding from the last motion meeting. We will now move on to the next item, and that is operation of the Hong Kong section of the Guangzhou Shenzhen Hong Kong XRL. I will not read out all the relevant papers. Please invite the administration to join us. Will members who would like to ask questions press their request to speak button? Under ROP 83A, if members have a direct or indirect pecuniary interest in any of the items on the agenda, please disclose the nature of the interest involved before you speak on that item. Mr. Michael Tian submitted a motion on the operation of the XRL and 2 motions on the CSL, and they are already tabled. And if you have motions in relation to the items on our agenda, please send them in ASAP. Ms. Tanya Chen came into the meeting room the earliest, and she has other commitment, and she would like to be the first to ask questions. All right, thank you. Secretary, welcome to the meeting. Do you have any introductory remarks? Yes, please, Chairman. Chairman, the Hong Kong Guangzhou Zhuhai, Hong Kong Shenzhen Guangdong XRL commenced operation the 23rd of September, and the MTR CEO is the operator of the XRL. We would like to report to you matters related to the operation. Operation has been smooth so far, and many members of the public have chosen to use XRL for cross-boundary transport. There have been over 3.4 passengers since its commissioning, and the daily patronage is over 15,000. As for the ratio of Hong Kong residents and non-Hong Kong residents among the passengers of the XRL, Hong Kong residents accounts for about 30%, and for non-Hong Kong residents, including mainland and passengers and passengers of other nationalities, they account for about 70%. Although there are more non-Hong Kong residents using the XRL, the patronage of the exile in the first 2 months of operation, and the ratio of Hong Kong residents in this period cannot be the basis for forecasting the future patronage. And the patronage will continue to rise after the link has been in operation for a while. As for ticketing arrangements, there was the National Day holidays, and there were more non-mainland residents buying tickets from the mainland ticketing website. There were more mainland passengers collecting their tickets at the WKS, and the operator has already increased the number of ticketing machines and to facilitate mainland passengers to purchase, to alter, and to refund the tickets. The MTLCL will keep a close eye on the need of passengers and improve the arrangements where necessary, and is also considering to enhance the ticketing system of the mainland. We hope that in the near future, Hong Kong residents can purchase tickets at the mainland ticketing website using an email or a mainland registered mobile phone number to purchase mainland sections, tickets of the mainland sections of the XRL. The XRL is an important transport infrastructure, and Hong Kong has benefited from the synergy brought about by the development of the Greater Bay Area, and it can help us to establish the 1 hour life cycle, a life circle of the Bay Area. We will ensure that the MTLCL is in a sound financial position to operate the rail, and the operator will continue to communicate with different stakeholders to enhance passenger experience on riding the XRL. The MTLCL will continue to promote XRL to various sectors. It will cooperate with the tourism industry to start or to launch more products using the XRL. I will now give the floor to the MTLCL for a briefing, and we'll be happy to take questions from members. Thank you.
Thank you. Please brief. Thank you, Chairman. Thank you, Mr. Chen. The XRL has commenced operation for 2 months or more. Everything, generally speaking, is going smoothly. And on passenger side, I want to speak on 2 points. In the past 2 months, the number of passengers exceeded 3.4 million passenger trips. They are growing. And in the coming Christmas and Chinese New Year holidays, taking XRL will be very common, and it will be the peak season. We expect that there will be more people using XRL, and we are working very closely with the Chinese Railway Authorities to monitor the situation, and we are prepared to cope with the rise in passenger numbers and to ensure that the operation is smooth. This is a new cross-border traffic facility. People need to adjust to that and adapt to and adjust their habits of traveling. After people have got to know the comfort and convenience of our service, they will more will patronize the XRL. And we have contacted various types of target groups for business, for business travel, for leisure travel, for visiting friends and relatives in the mainland. We hope that more will patronize the XRL. We work with different trades and industries to expand the marketing network. We work very closely with the tourism industry through a multi-pronged approach. We attract various types of passengers. We hope that more passengers will enjoy the XRL service. Since its commencement at the station, our colleagues have taken various measures to facilitate the use. For example, we've improved the arrangement for queuing up. We've increased number of counters for collecting tickets and machines and terminals for collecting tickets. We have conducted an opinion survey. Passengers have reflected positively on the service of XRL. We will provide a reliable service to make our service better. In the middle of December, in West Kowloon Station will have an opinion zone. And we hope that through this activity, we can listen to the views of more customers and passengers. Thank you. I believe that in the beginning, there were some hiccups with the operation of the XRL, but they have been overcome. Now, this item will last until 9:30. 11 members are waiting in the line, 4 minutes each, and there is only one round and no second round. And after is Daniel Chen has, after Mr. Chen Hangban has spoken, I will draw a line there. First, Ms. Tanya Chen, followed by Lau Kok Fan, Lo Wai, Kualam Chak Teng, Ao Chok Nok Hin, Chu Hoi Tik, Pun Siu Peng, Cheng Chung Tai, Luk Chung Hong, Yu Siu Wing, Chen Hangban. Ms. Tanya Chen. Thank you, Chairman. I was unable to participate in the discussion of the SCL discussion. Therefore, I am unable to participate in the discussion of the SCL, so I have tabled a letter. I hope members can follow that up. As for the XRL, together with the colleagues of my party, we wrote to the XRL, and that is in respect of a name list. It is said that the above provisions are applicable to the XRL Hong Kong section. The person who has been discredited on the list can so bar from the pay area, so they are not able to get within the turnstiles. With regard to the rules for the passengers and also the Supreme People's Court's provisions concerning people who have been discredited, and also the collection of personal information in the XRL station. Now, with regard to this name list, it is a provision under the mainland law, and also in Rule 11 of the XRL operation, the following passenger have the rights, and also the relevant rules may apply in Hong Kong. And also the disclosure of personal information. It is said that it is possible that the name ID and other personal information for the purchase of tickets may be supplied to a third party, including those in the mainland, and the third party may not be subject to the privacy ordinance in Hong Kong, and buyers beware. And you can disclaim that. I want to ask the secretary. Usually, he asks the one that is back to brief us. Now, can you tell us that this statement can overrule the protection of Hong Kong people by Hong Kong law? Even if it is within the turnstile, it's still not within the port of the mainland in West Kowloon. So can this piece of paper overrule and overturn the protection given to the people of Hong Kong? The Secretary. Well, with regard to those persons discredited, this is the in relation to the arrangement between the XRL and the passengers. Have you asked the DOJ or the Privacy Commissioner whether this can be dealt with in such a way? Basically, the information will not be given to any other law enforcement agencies. It's not the SARG, it's the XRL, it is the MTR. Chairman. Basically, I've said this is a ticketing arrangement. As for the handling of information in detail, the MTRC can supplement. Thank you, Chairman. I hope members understand this. This is a cross-boundary service. Our ticketing Our ticketing system has to be tied in with the mainland ticketing system. I have asked whether they have sought legal advice. It is really very messy. Will the MTLC and also the secretary answer in writing? Yes, we will comply. Next, Mr. Lau Kok Fan. Now, according to your paper, the intercity train has experienced a decline of 28% in patronage. And it is said that it will consider whether there is the need to adjust the intercity direct train. The XLL does affect, or rather the direct train, intercity direct train does affect Israel, and it affects the schedule of the Israel. Now, if there is a decline of 28% in patronage, will you consider the schedule of the through train, the intercity through train, so as to enhance the frequency of the Israel? The Secretary. With regard to Mr. Lau's question, we understand that with the commencement of the XRL, the traffic patterns of passengers and citizens will change. And this is in as for the impact on the Israel, I think the impact is only a change of 1%. We'll keep an eye on the situation and see what we will do, depending on the developments. Do you have a timetable on the review? Now, after you've looked at the numbers and after you've done your calculation, then you can come up with some results. The Secretary. Chairman. With regard to traffic and transport and also traveling needs, we need to be realistic. We need to understand some situation. We need to understand the pattern more thoroughly before we can come to a conclusion. The XRL also brings people to Lo Wu. And that may affect the Israel. I understand Mr. Lau's concern. The Israel takes care of the residents in NT-Northeast, and we will respond to that if there is any change. I'm concerned about the residents in NT-East, and I hope a review can be conducted as soon as possible. On the 26th of October, you add during weekends and also Fridays, you add 9 more trains. The point-to-point service, say to Shantou, Hunan, the number of point-to-point service is not good enough, and you may need to change in Shenzhen if the schedule point-to-point schedule does not meet your need. So will you increase the frequency of point-to-point service? Well, we have the target of getting more point-to-point service and increasing frequency, but we have to consider the efficiency of the railway network. Our understanding with the railway authority is that where possible, we'll provide more stops, and also depending on the change in patronage. And when it comes to the time that there is a need, we may consider increasing frequencies. As for the operation of the XRL, there is a need to conduct further discussions. I've already said that after the first member who have spoken, I will draw a line. Now, Mr. Michael Tin is the last one, and no one can be added after him. With the commencement of XRL, the XRL service has been very popular among travelers. I expect that passengers will continue to increase. I have a question on park and ride. In West Kowloon, there is a car park, and concession is given to those who park and ride, the XRL. I don't know what is your estimate on the demand for parking, whether it is day parking or short-term parking. If more and more adopt the park and ride mode, will the parking spaces be saturated, just like the situation in the airport? So what is your estimate? Many have said that if there can be midnight trains for overnight trains for long distance travel, that will be, for long haul, that will be good. And if you have to work and you travel during the day for 7 or 8 hours, that will be a deterrent to long haul travelers. But if you have night trains, sleeper trains, that will be very welcome by long-haul travelers. Chairman, I just want to give my view on SEL because I'm not able to participate in the discussion because of another engagement. Together, some of my friends and myself have the view that taking sample and also opening the concrete to conduct tests is scientific and reasonable. Whether the sampling can be expanded, a suitable balance has to be sought. Now, after opening up the concrete, if the situation is not desirable, will there be the need to expand the sampling area? I think there should be a discussion on that.
And regarding the assessment on the structural safety after the sampling, I think it is also important. I did say that load test is a way to tell whether the platforms are safe or not. I hope we can have an answer next time. But of course, for this session, please tackle questions related to the XRL. Thank you. Regarding park and ride arrangement for the XRL, I've tried it out myself. It's very convenient. And if I remember correctly, you will only pay $100 for a 24-hour parking period. And if there are other, what about midnight trains? Yes, this was raised in my meeting with the mainland authorities, but this is about the operation of the whole railway network. Night is a time for repair and maintenance. They do have night trains, but the number is limited. We have expressed this aspiration to them, but we'll continue to see whether that's possible. My colleague will talk about park and ride arrangement. Well, during the Golden Week for the National Day celebrations, the parking places were taken up. How many are there in total? 500 or so. Mr. Lam Cheuk-ting, the patronage of the Israel line is already saturated. Residents of the North District in particular, in view of a further increase of population by 300,000, we have asked the administration to consider whether we can have new mass transit, mass transport system to lessen the burden on the North District. And we're told previously that with the commissioning of the XRL, some passengers would be diverted away from the East Rail, and the patronage will drop. However, the daily patronage of the East Rail is still 310,000. That's only a drop of 1% since the commissioning of the XRL. So the effect of the XRL for diverting passengers away from the XRL is limited. Secretary, I'd like to know how far has this deviated from your initial assessment? Starting from 2023, there will be a new population to Northeast NT, and then up to 2030, there will be about 300,000 people moved into the Northeast NT development. So how are you going to address the great demand for transport into the urban areas? Land transport is very congested. Traffic congestion is serious along Shatin and Taipo during peak hours. So how are you going to address the great demand for transport infrastructure? Secretary, thank you, Mr. Lam, for your comments and question. I don't think our assessment of the impact of the XRL on the East Rail is included in our forecast. I think we will talk about the intercity through train. The XRL has got a few short-haul destinations and some long-haul destinations. The impact on the daily traveling pattern of the local population is minimal. Now, the East Rails, the cross-boundary stop is in Kwantung North, whereas for the XR is Kwantung South. Yes, I understand what Mr. Lam is saying. That is, the East Rail is already saturated and the Tolo Highway is also very congested. For the Tolo Shatin section of the Tolo Highway, we've already secured funding for widening for two-way. Well, this is already understood, but that will not be able to satisfy the transport demand of another 300,000 people. It is incredible that one more lane on the Tolo Highway can address that. We are talking about the huge transport demand from the new population into Northeast NT. Yes, we discussed T4 trunk road in the council some time ago. However, we failed to get majority support of the council. However, the T4 trunk road will help to alleviate traffic burden here. But for Kai Lang, Outau, we are now conducting a study on traffic infrastructure to be provided there. Mr. Ao Nok Kin, Ms. Tanya Chen, just talk about the discredited persons under the social credit system of the mainland. I think in Hong Kong, we have really introduced the social credit system into Hong Kong. They have imposed this on Hong Kong. As Tsingtao said, MTLCL has suggested to the mainland. Now, I don't know whether the report is true or not, but the MTLCL has tried to have Hong Kong exempted, but the reply was it was a national system and it was not possible. So I'd like the MTLCL to confirm whether it has indeed asked for an exemption. And here, this rule for the XRL has got the provisions. and that is the basis of the social credit system. And we don't even know when you signed the regulations or rules with the mainland authorities. Yes. We have explained on various occasions that the XLL Hong Kong link is a cross-boundary railway. It would be irresponsible if we sell you a ticket which will not enable you to travel to across the boundary. And as we explained, based on relevant laws and regulations, now all these can be found on the internet. Therefore, there is a list of discredited persons which is announced on the internet of the mainland. So there is no question of not making open. No, no, no. I'm not saying that you have not published this, but you are using MTLCL to impose mainland laws or the social credit system into Hong Kong blatantly. And if you have tried to ask for exemption to no avail, at least there should be an appeal system. All right, if Hong Kong residents have got their list included, then have the names included on the list, can there be any appeal channel? Perhaps there is a mistake. Can we say no to the system? I think your question has already been answered. It's just that Mr. Ao doesn't accept it. Yes, the system of having a list of discredited persons, I already explained that it is a system implemented by the mainland for persons who have to ride on the XLL. As I said, the XLL Hong Kong link is part of the cross-boundary network. And if we sell a ticket to someone and the ticket will not allow them to travel to across the boundary, it is irresponsible. All right, you have tried to fight for us, but you have failed. Or you talked about the patronage projection. Now you have failed to achieve your original forecast. Will you revise it? Will you revise your projection on your financial position, including EBITDA? I think that is premature, but please have a go, Secretary. We understand Mr. Ao's concern. But the daily patronage has been on the rise, so it is not necessary to amend it. We have to adopt a realistic approach. And the financial position of the XLL Hong Kong link is good or stable, and we do not see any negative impacts or negative factors on our operation, so we will continue to operate in this manner. Mr. Eddie Chu, yes, I have two questions. The administration has to admit that whether it be the overall patronage or the ratio of Hong Kong residents among the passengers of the XLL, the reality is a far cry from your original targets. In August, the expected daily, Deputy Secretary said that during weekdays, the daily patronage should be 72,000, and at weekends, 78,000, and also at peak times, 90,000 per day. So, when actually the daily patronage is only 50,000 passengers, and you have not given us a breakdown of short haul and long haul passengers. We were told in the past that 80% of the passengers would be short haul passengers and 20% long haul passengers. I'd like you to give us a breakdown of the 50,000 passengers riding on the MTR on the XLL daily. And can you tell us, now for Futian, you get $74 in per ticket and $112 for Guangzhou for apportionment of the fare revenue. So can you tell us how much you have got as a result? And you've already spent $71.4 billion for contracts awarded, and you've also got claims outstanding. There are about $9.6 billion outstanding claims. So can we can I say that if we add the two sums together to arrive at $81 billion, and that is the total expenditure by the government on the XRL Hong Kong Link Secretary, we understand that Mr. Zhu cares for the XRL project, and he has given us very a lot of details in his question. And yes, my questions are very direct. Can you be more direct in your reply? Sure. Now, we don't have the details at hand. We will reply to Mr. Zhu's questions in paper later. And as for whether the expenditure plus the claims will be the total expenditure, as I said, there are many disputes, and then we are reserving our position, and we cannot confirm any figures before that is settled. But this is strange, because on your paper, you have got very real figures, claims resolved and claims unresolved. So for claims unresolved, can you confirm that the number will not increase from 808 as stated on the paper? Well, that is our latest situation. Now, for claims unresolved, we will have to first confirm whether they are can be substantiated and whether the award can be changed. I think Mr. G's question is, will there be a change in the number of claims? The number of claims is something between the MTRCL and its contractors. Let me see if MTRCL has got anything to add. All right. The question is whether the number of claims will increase, yes or no? That is the latest situation.
Tell me your question is right. If we know that they have capped it at $80.8 billion, then and cannot be added, then it cannot be added. Well, you really don't know whether there are new ones. Now, with the commencement of the XRL, about 3 million passenger trips were made, and that's about 50,000 passenger trips per day. And some members asked for the impact on the through train and also the East Rail. The impact on the through train is more obvious. Now, you keep an eye on the number of through train passengers and may consider whether there's a need to adjust the through train service. What will be the level that will trigger the adjustment? And what is your preliminary idea with regard to adjustment to the through train? Railway safety is very important. In para 11, you said that safety is of paramount importance, and an operation agreement has been signed, and that covers repair and maintenance. I've asked how many repair and maintenance staff do you have? You say about 700. Now, some members, some staff members were working in other yards, but they are now being put back to the repair and maintenance section. So how many are doing repair and maintenance within the MTRCL? And do you have difficulties in recruiting staff members to do this job with the commencement of XRL in West Kowloon Station? It was said that there were illegal workers in West Kowloon Station. There are security guards, there are cleansing workers, the staff members should be supervised by the MTRC. So what system do you have to deal with recruitment? And what is the supervision on contractors and subcontractors with regard to the employment of workers? With regard to future adjustment resolutions, the priority is to meet the needs of Hong Kong residents, Hong Kong citizens, and the passengers. It all depends on the number of passengers and also the traveling patterns of the people of Hong Kong. As for the operation agreement concerning the recruitment of staff members, the MTRC will answer the questions. Thank you for the questions. A safe and reliable system is our priority. So maintenance and operation are very important. We've said that within the establishment, we have MTRC colleagues and contractor workers doing the job. And in the early days of operation, we've met with the peaks during the Lunar New Year and the Golden Week. We therefore seconded staff from other lines to ensure the smooth operation of the XRL. These seconded staff members have now gone back to their original place of service. As for cleansing workers and security guards, though the services are contracted out, they have to observe the standards set by us, and we monitor the level of service, and we will take action if they fail to reach the standard. Next, Mr. Cheng Chung Tai. Ms. Alina Wong, Ms. Claudia Mo, Mr. Leung Chi Hong, and Mr. Ho Kai Ming have asked to speak after I've drawn the line. My apologies to them, I cannot allow them the floor. Mr. Cheng Chung Tai, Dr. Cheng Chung Tai. The Hong Kong residents took up a very low proportion of using the XRL. Now, according to the Railway Subcommittee, the previous Railway Committee, it was estimated that by 2016, when the XRL commenced operation, Hong Kong residents accounted for 24% for business travel and 46% on business travel. But now the number is only 28 to 32%. That is completely the opposite of your estimate. Why this is so? Have you tried to understand this? The estimate is contrary to the fact. It was said that the expected gross profit is 34 to 40%, but according to government paper 2018, the gross profit is expected to be 29.6%. And according to today's paper, there is no clear number as to the operating gross profit. The ticketing revenue, non-ticketing revenue, franchises, and also rental income, so on and so forth. There is no breakdown. There is no detail. Can you provide information to us? Thank you, Chairman. Thank you, Dr. Cheng. With regard to the composition of passengers, the number referred to by Dr. Cheng was made long time ago. The recent estimates was a split of 50-50. Now the split is 30-70, Hong Kong versus non-Hong Kong travelers. It takes time for Hong Kong travelers to have a better understanding of the XRL. We will continue to work hard on promoting the use of XRL. The XRL is most attractive with regard to a traveling time of 4 hours or less, and we expect that there will be more patrons in the Lunar New Year, and I believe the number of Hong Kongers taking the XRL will increase with time. As for operational profits, the EBITDA, we've just started operation on the 23rd of September. After the operational situation has stabilized, after we have our annual accounts, we'll report to members in due course. I hope that can address Dr. Cheng's concern. Chairman, if I may follow up, the Secretary said that local tour groups and local people were making use of XRL. As at the 15th of November 2018, local tour groups, 21,000 people. This is a very low number, a small number, if you compare with tours, local tours departing through other means. In the coming holiday seasons, what is the change you expect? This we have just started a very short time. We still doing the preparatory work. Maybe MDRCL can supplement. If you look at the number of tour groups, the number is rising rapidly. Now, from the start till mid-November, there were about 400 groups. From middle of November until Christmas, the number of tour groups the number of groups increased to 300. We will continue to organize more groups so that more citizens will make use of the XRL. Next, Mr. LUK Chung-hung. Sorry, speaker's not coming through. Yes, Chairman. Last weekend, I went to Chiu Chau Shantou. I took the MTR, I took the XRL and experienced the travel. It's very convenient, it's cheap, $181. But many ask me, they don't understand the mechanism. Why is more expensive if you travel to Guangzhou? You take 2 hours to Chiu Chau Shantou, but you pay $242 if you travel to Guangzhou. The ticketing mechanism or the pricing is very strange. If it is northward traveling, then it's from West Kowloon to Guangzhou south. If you go to Shantou, it's only from Hong Kong to Shenzhen north. And then that's for the XR mechanism. And then afterwards, you pay the mainland fare price. You pay the mainland fare. So people are not happy with the pricing arrangement. If you travel to Guangzhou South, if you buy separate tickets from West Kowloon to Shenzhen North, $85, and then Shenzhen North to Guangzhou, $84.5 equivalent Hong Kong dollar. Well, total $169.5, but if you buy the XR ticket in Hong Kong, $242. Have you reflected on this? Is it not the reason for less patronage? For those who are not in a hurry, they will not pay, say, 40% more of fare to buy the XRL ticket. Whether you give a concession or you cut the fare, you need to make a change. The next is the ticketing system. The mobile app by the MTRCL is useless. If you punch the timetable, they just give you a PDF and ask you to read. Such an app is really useless. It makes the MTRCL a laughing stock. When will you have a more user-friendly app? And finally, after we've bought the ticket, we want to get useful information when we enter the turnstile. When will we be able to get an electronic ticket or use our ID card, just like in the mainland, to enter the turnstile, to pass through the turnstile? The arrangement has reduced your efficiency. And also, that is the X-ray machine. In front of the X-ray machine, there's a long queue. Thank you, Mr. Lok, for the questions. First, on fare level and concession. The XRL has the effective rate and also the announced rate. Depending on the situation, there can be adjustments. But it will not be higher than the announced rate. As for traveling to Shantou, Chuqiao, you take the train to Shenzhen North and then Guangfu Shen Line. And that's for a smart traveler. If you go to Guangzhou South, you will have to make a change. You have to change in Shenzhen North. Time is money. I think different travelers will make the wise choice. As for the ticket sale network in Hong Kong, we want the mainland network 12306 can be extended to Hong Kong so that Hong Kong citizens can buy tickets through the internet in Hong Kong and can also buy the mainland section tickets. Because the system in Hong Kong is different from that of mainland, there is a need to make a certain transitional arrangement. If there can be a change in the system so that Hong Kong travelers can buy tickets through email or through other means, that will be better. And there are e-tickets. You can use your mobile phone to show your e-tickets. But many only have the first generation home return permit. We need a system that takes care of all the types of people in Hong Kong. And there are people who've got used to using paper tickets. Now, in promoting buying tickets through the internet, we'll work hard on this. We'll work with the MTRCL.
Well, regarding the operation of the apps, you can communicate among yourselves after the meeting. Mr. Yu Siwing, let me declare interest. My company is an agent for XRL tickets. We thank the MTRCL for simplifying the procedures for travel agents to buy tickets. And the number of tour groups has risen from 40 to 300 during a very short period of time. I welcome that move. I think members of the public are interested in riding the XRL for traveling to the mainland, but perhaps it's because of misleading information about the co-location arrangements, so on and so forth. There was some negative impression, and I think members of the public are now confident in riding the XRL. However, some are of the view that the XRL is not that convenient for the light rail cross-boundary service. They can buy tickets at any time and they don't need to provide any proof of identity. So can you consider simplifying the procedures for the Shenzhen section so that members of the public feel that it is just as convenient as the Lovu section? And currently, the procedures are very complicated, and some people don't know how to get to the WKS. Some members of the public do not understand the XRL operation, including the collocation arrangements and how to get to the station. Can you all arrange experience days so that passengers can try riding on the XRL at a very low rate? It's just like publicity. There were too much negative publicity back then, and then you can provide positive publicity, and the proportion of Hong Kong residents is only 30%. This is on the low side. And for the discount, you only offer 87%, but this is not good enough. For Shenzhen and Guangzhou, there are 25 pairs and 30 pairs of trains on a daily basis, respectively. Perhaps you can further lower the fares so more people can benefit. For concessions and operation, can the MTRCL respond? Mr. Lau, thank you. Thank you, Mr. Yu, for your comments. Yes, we have noted your comments. We will continue to explore with you on these matters. Mr. Yu talked about short-haul trips and whether passengers can need not buy tickets in advance. I think we are in a position to do that because there are more short-haul trips, and then more tickets are available. We will publicize this more so that passengers will understand that there is no need for advanced purchase of tickets for short-haul journeys, and whether we can offer experience days on the MTL at low fares, yes, that can be considered. Sometimes there is a discount of 13% for some trips compared to the announced fares. We will discuss with the other party to see whether we can offer discount on more trains to encourage people to use it. We'll discuss with the CR, China Railway Corporation. Mr. Chen Hanbang, I ride on the XRL quite often. I find it convenient and comfortable, but there are areas where improvement is needed. For instance, the apps is really not convenient. I have to queue up to collect the ticket at the station, and that takes time. I want to know whether MTRCL can discuss with CR, and can the mainland ticketing website 12306 be made available for Hong Kong use? If we cannot use the app to purchase tickets, this is very inconvenient. Can we ask CR to allow Hong Kong people to set up an account in the on the website? I don't know whether the MTRCL is willing to negotiate with CR on our behalf. And as for the luggage restrictions, the MTRCL is discussing with CR on relaxing the restriction on luggage you can carry. I'd like to know the outcome of that discussion. Now, there are over 90 pairs of trains running every day. Now, for some popular destinations, such as Fuzhou, some would like to have more trains, but very often trains to Fujian would only stop at Xiamen. Can there be more trains with Fuzhou as a destination? And now the collocation arrangements are really convenient and efficient. After we've passed the clearance checkpoints, the waiting area is very congested. Can boarding be allowed earlier, so that the waiting area will not be too crowded. If the train has already arrived, can we be allowed to board the train at once, so we don't have to queue up for boarding the train again? Our service is always excellent, so can we further improve the arrangements? Thank you. I will answer some of the questions, and MTRCL can assist afterwards. Yes, we share the aspirations of the public. We want to provide a reliable, convenient online ticket purchasing experience, and we are now discussing with CR to see whether 12306 can be expanded to Hong Kong, extended to Hong Kong. However, for this system, they need proof of identity, and there has to be a message sent to a phone number registered on the mainland. So we will see whether the system can be extended to Hong Kong. And after these technical issues are overcome, we will try to extend the website to Hong Kong, so passengers here can use it. However, this is a big system, and it takes time for the arrangements. Mr. Lee, thank you. First, the luggage arrangement. As we all know, passengers do need to carry suitcases with them. We are discussing with CR, but we have to understand that this is a cross-boundary service, and we have to come up with a mechanism agreeable to both sides, and we are trying our best to make arrangements for passengers to take their luggage with them. And as for Fuzhou, the mainland has an excellent network, and there is a great demand. But we do hear the comments from members, and we'll try whether we can have more destinations. And as for allowing passengers to board the trains as early as possible, this is a very good suggestion. You don't have to explain, just follow up. Mr. Tong Lizi, thank you. Of course, the XRL has provided a very expeditious and convenient and comfortable mode of transport to the mainland. I think MTRCL should continue to adjust the destinations and the service hours and the frequencies as we go along. Now, currently, the main concern is buying tickets. Members have commented on buying a ticket online. And as for collection of tickets, the procedures and also the time required are more complicated than that of the mainland, and we have to input a lot of numbers. So can we try to simplify the collection process? It's not easy for some passengers to remember and to input so many figures. Perhaps in the mainland, they have their home return permits, and we have a new generation of home return cards. And for when you head towards a certain destinations, you have to arrive at the station and complete the clearance procedures well ahead of the departure time. I thought the waiting area was very big, when actually it isn't. So can you make arrangements about this? As for the total expenditure for building the XRL, I'd like to follow up as well. Now for the claims, I'd like to know whether there is a cutoff point for contractors to submit claims. Is there a deadline for contractors to submit claims? And in the annex to the paper, claims resolved, we have a table on claims resolved and claims unresolved. For claims resolved, the amount claimed originally was 16 odd billion dollars. I'd like to know when 9.5 billion dollars was awarded. What do you mean by claims resolved? Because there is another column on claims unresolved. And I think they should give me a written reply. Here it talks about cost due to price escalations, unfavorable ground conditions, changes in design to suit actual site conditions, and various unforeseen circumstances. Can you give us a breakdown of the reasons for the claims? While we have put a cap on the total expenditure, that doesn't mean that we shouldn't be informed of the various reasons for the claims. Yes, please provide a written reply because there is no time left. Yes, Mr. Tony Z is asking for very detailed figures. And the situation reported here is as at the 30th of September, which is quite a while away from now already.
Mr. Michael Tian, now the agreement with the MTRCL is self-financing. The MTRCL should do its best to promote its business. Anyone taking MTR to West Kowloon and then take the XRL should be free of charge in respect of the traveling by MTR. Those living in Hong Kong, on Hong Kong side, will save over $10. They don't need to consider the through bus or direct bus or other means to the mainland. Now you have signed an agreement with the MTRCL. You should give them the opportunity to run make a good business. Now, there is concession for transfer for taking the airport railway. So why don't you adopt this simple approach to get more business? The MTRCL is a listed company, the government says, and therefore it is not appropriate for the government to interfere with the operation of the MTRC. So what is the answer from the MTRC in respect of giving concessions? Mr. Lau, I thank Mr. Tian for his view. Like other promotion campaigns, will consider this. In the past 2 months or so, the number of patronage is rising steadily. Originally, with regard to the announced fare level, jointly decided with the China Railway Authorities, we believe that this price level is competitive. We have the announced fare level and also the implemented fare level or effective fare level. And in order to attract more passengers, we have flexibility in adjusting the fare level. Mr. Lau, you're not answering my question. The China Railway Authority will not interfere with the concession you offer in the MTR service to attract more people to patronize the XRL. If There are hundreds of thousands of people patronizing XRL every day. You are bursting to the seams. Then you don't need to provide any concession. But now the number is very small, and that's the problem. As I've said, Mr. Lau, as I've said, in the past 2 months or so, the number of patrons are rising. They're not rising. And your estimate is was 80 to 90,000 per day, and now you only have 50,000 per day. So it's a low number. Why don't you do something to attract people to the XRL? There is the operational agreement. You're open for 2 to 3 months. I don't care about the first month. But now number has stabilized. You cannot reach 80,000 or 90,000 per day. That's the problem. Yes, Mr. Lau. Do you say that you reject my proposal? Why the airport railway provide such a concession? Chairman, as I said, the objective is to get more patrons to the XRL. We will consider different promotional efforts. Will you do that then? No clear answer. He said he would consider different ways. Now we have to deal with the motion moved by Mr. Michael Tian. Now please put it on the projector. Mr. Tian, please read out your motion. MTRCL is responsible for the operation of the XRL Hong Kong section, and it has to operate on a self-financing basis. It should do its best to attract more passengers. And increase its rate of return. We therefore urge the administration to ask the MTRCL to provide a transfer concession so as to increase the number of passengers of XRL and increase the passenger flow. Now voting begins. Please cast your vote. Please check your vote. Voting is closed. The result displayed. 9-4, no objection, no abstention. The motion is carried. All right, we move on to the next item on the agenda. And that is the progress of the SCL. Let us invite the officials to enter the room. Yes, we can only extend our meeting by 15 minutes. We have to hand over the room at 10:45 to the next meeting. Let's see how many like to speak. Please press the bell. Press the button if you want to speak. 11. Right. 4 minutes each. Well, that's rather close. Okay, 3 minutes each. Usually the answer is longer than that. If I add 15 minutes, it will be 10:45. I can't add any more. The Secretary, do you have any introduction? As for MTRCL introduction, please be short. I assume the members read your paper. Well, the Secretary. Thank you, Chairman. Earlier on, we reported to the Subcommittee the update as at the 30th of September 2018, and we now update members on the latest situation of the MTRCL. The administration is unable to understand the actual construction details of the Hong Kong station. Therefore, experts and the departments concerned and the MTRCL have several meetings to deal with the way to handle this. The government asked MTRCL to formulate comprehensive policy to confirm the structural situation of the Hong Kong station. On the 15th of October, the administration received the first strategic proposal by the MTRCL. After the team of experts and the government departments scrutinized the proposal, we have the view that the scope is too narrow. It's only consider checking east west corridor, but exclude the north-south corridor and the continuing wall. It cannot fulfill the requirement of comprehensive assessment. Therefore, the government team asked the MTRCL to provide the comprehensive assessment strategy covering all the Hong Kong Station extended section. The government and the expert team and the MTRCL had many meetings and concerning the 23rd November comprehensive assessment strategy proposal. They exchanged views on the 4th December. The government received a comprehensive strategy proposal from the MTRC. It is the amended version. After scrutiny, we accepted the proposal. We have the view that the comprehensive assessment strategy should give priority to safety based on evidence and based on statistic principles. This is to clarify and identify the east-west corridor and north-south corridors' overall safety. The MTR is unable to provide the drawings and construction records. All these records. Though later they attempted to provide such information, the drawings, the photos are not complete. Therefore, it is necessary to dig up the concrete to conduct actual inspection. This is the first step of digging up the concrete. In view of the steel bars and bolts, which are suspected to have been cut, the MTRCL has to dig up a part of the panels to conduct inspection and cause non-intrusive testing to assess the connection of the bolts and bars. As for the places for digging up, it will be done by sampling, by random sampling, and there will be three phases. First phase, MTRCL check the records. And in the second phase, MTRCL, according to insufficient works information and works data and quality problems in north, south, and west, east corridor, there will be 80 locations which will be dug up to check the details of the bars and the bolts and the connections. The MTRC will use non-invasive inspection method to check whether the bolts are securely connected. And depending on the situation, number of samples will increase in phase three. The MTRCL, based on the results of the first two phases, will consider other works quality issues and conduct detailed structural analysis. And if need be, remedial works will have to be designed. And if need be, loading tests will be conducted to ensure that the extended section of Hong Kong Station is complete. And we will we have accepted the assessment proposal of the MTRCL. As at the end of November 2018, the progress of SEL is 88% complete. In view of the Hong Kong station situation, the target commencement date of the SEL will to be reviewed. As for SEL to Central, the target is commencement 2021. The government has asked MTRCL to open a part of the SEL. Because of the technical complexity, the MTRCL has to take time to consider. The proposal will work with the MTRCL. At present, there is no conclusion. Chairman, I'd like to ask the MTRCL to give you a briefing on the progress of the SEL and also the assessment strategy. Would the Secretary give a speaking note for our reference first? You mean now? Now, before the MTR gives the briefing, we have less than 50 minutes before a quarter to 11. So I'll give 3 minutes to each member, and I will stop you right on the dot. I have to deal with Mr. Michael Tian's two motions. Chairman, in the next 5 minutes, I will briefly speak on the progress of the SCL. As at the end of November, the overall progress is 88% completed. Taiwai to Hong Kong, 99% completed. As for extension to Emerald, more than 75% completed. From Taiwai to Hong Kong, the topping up was first in Hin Kiang. We have broadly completed the infrastructure installation and also statutory checks. As for Diamond Station, Diamond Hill, we are doing the works are substantially completed. As for Kai Tak, the statutory inspections have been completed, and we are gradually handing over the stations to our operational division. Song Wong Toi and Toko Wan stations, we are conducting the statutory inspections, and we hope that by the end of the year, the inspections will be completed. As a Hong Kong station, we are doing the installations, E&M and building services installations. We will conduct verification and testing soon, and we will provide more. We'll provide more details. As for Hong Kong to Emerald, the new immersed tube tunnel will extend the East Rail across the harbour. The 11 units have been completed, and we are now doing the full final connections, and by early 2019, the whole tunnel will be completed. Our target is early next year, we will lay the tracks. Mr. Cheung, how many slides do you have? Four or five. I think this is in your paper. I think if there is no specific matter you want to highlight, then please stop now. Well, let me finish first.
Now, in the past 12 months, we've completed 4 to 7 and 7 to 8 trains for the Shatin to Taiwan section and Hong Kong to Emerald section. We hope that we can have a full commissioning in next year, and whether we can do that depends on the situation of Hong Kong Station. It is already 10 a.m. I don't know whether I will have time to deal with the motions. We have three. Mr. Chang can just added one. Ms. Claudia Mo, Secretary, can you allow a few minutes for a for Dr. Kam to talk about the full assessment, holistic proposal? Well, members will ask questions on that already, but we want to be more thorough. Then we may not be able to complete to allow everyone to ask questions. Dr. Kam, thank you. The purpose of the holistic proposal is to ensure safety and integrity of the station. There are two objectives. First, to verify the constructed condition of the platform slabs are consistent with the latest design and amendment drawings. And the second, to assess the workmanship of the coupler connections. That will be done in three stages. First, compile and check the design amendment drawings. And second, on-site physical investigation. And three, we'll have to consolidate all information available. We'll conduct an analysis before deciding whether the station is safe and structurally intact. All right, very briefly, I'll go through the three stages. First, we will verify the drawings. The contractor has already submitted the latest design amendment drawings. The MTRCL and our consultants will check the design amendment drawings against construction records and photos. We will look at objective data available, such as photos taken during construction. second stage, we have a few considerations. First, the whole opening up process cannot compromise the integrity and safety of the structure. We have to verify the as constructed condition where there are changes, and when information is incomplete, we will open up the concrete. And second is to assess the workmanship. This will be done by random sampling. If you are familiar with quality management, you know we have to use a random sampling to do that. All right. The first purpose of opening up is to verify the as constructed conditions. There are 24 locations where there are amendments, and we have to verify the as constructed condition. And second purpose, now I think you may be more interested about the EWL platform slab. At 28 locations of the EWL and also 28 locations of the NSL, we will have a minimum of 168 steel bar copper connection random samples. Now for the NSL platform, because it sits on the ground, so if we have to look at the bottom, then we may have to excavate, and this is not safe. So we'll not cover the bottom part, and we have commissioned the University of Hong Kong to do that for it. We will be present during the assessment, but the locations will be taken on a random basis. So random sampling on the EWL and NSL platform slab at different depth. Now, we'll have 24 locations on EWL and also 28 on the NSL platform slab. So there will be 7 to 8, on average, about 7 to 8 meters we will open up the slab. Now for non-destructive tests, now if we have a coupler, we cannot just use visual inspection, and we cannot cut it because we would damage the structure. So we will have ultrasonic examination to see how far the coupler and also the bar are connected, and then we can verify the condition of steel bar spacing and quality of concrete. We can use a hammer test to ascertain the quality of the concrete. If there is honeycomb situation, that can be identified, and then the section has to be removed and recast. Stage 3. All the information will be consolidated and will be used in a holistic structural assessment. If need be, we will have remedial works. And then after today, we will try to complete the preparation work as fast as possible. Now, some of we will first remove the tracks and also railway facilities. We will maintain very close contact with the government. When necessary, we can enhance our testing. And when the work is completed, we will try to work out a long-term structural monitoring program to ensure that the safety to ensure safety and integrity of the structure, not just now, but in the long term. Thank you. I hope every member will have a chance to speak. So each member will have 2.5 minutes to speak. Ms. Claudia Mo. Thank you. 2.5 hours. Right, draw a line after that. Chairman, I must criticize the government for acting too slow. About 3 months ago, there were already calls for opening up and check. The government took no notice of such requests. Now it has decided to proceed. And as for the coupler connection, now there are over 20,000 coupler connections. And you are going to check no more than 200. That is less than 1% of the total. I think people are saying that you should at least check 5% of the connections to be meaningful. However, experts are saying that after you have opened up a certain area, even you recast it afterwards, there cannot be 100% load taking ability. So maybe 5% is too much, but 1% is too little. Can we say take it at 3%? Secretary, thank you, Ms. Mo, for your question. I hope you understand that the basis for our number of samples to be taken is based on scientific basis. Now, 84 samples will be enough, statistically speaking. Deviation will just be 3.5%. That's about the couplers. Now, even for the census we have in Hong Kong, we have 7 million people. If we use 5%, then we have to poll at least 350,000 Hong Kong people. This is not practical. I hope you understand that the sampling will be done by Hong Kong U independently. And if there is any abnormality defected, identified, we will continue with more samples. Mr. Luk Chung-hung, the residents are most concerned about when the SEO can be commissioned. And there were discussions that there might be partial commissioning, and some said that the rail may be commissioned to Diamond Hill to facilitate change of trains, and some say that it may be at Homantin. Now, is there room for trains to turn around when you want to have partial commissioning? And have you assessed the impact on Kwun Tong Line if you are going to commission the line on a partial basis? I have communicated with many members here. Residents in Kowloon East, or anyway, residents living along the alignment of the SEL have to suffer from traffic congestion, and they want the train, the line to be commissioned ASAP. Now, if we have completed the holistic assessment, if the structure is safe, then we can try to commission the train, the line ASAP. If not, we will try to see whether partial commissioning is possible. Of course, we want to benefit as many passengers as possible, but we have to consider the signaling system, the room for trains to turn around, so and so forth. As I said, we are discussing with MTRCL in great depth. When can you come to a conclusion? Many Kai Fongs are asking us this question. We'd like to let our members know ASAP as well. Let's see if the MTRCL has got anything to add. Dr. Kemp, roughly the same. Of course, we want SEL to be commissioned fully ASAP, and we are now studying the feasibility of partial commissioning. All options are being considered. It's not that so long as the station is there, we can commission it. there are other operational considerations and the impact on passengers. We have to consider the impacts of a full or partial commissioning. Yes, we do understand that. We have another meeting in 2 months' time. I hope you can give us further updates. Mr. Michael Tian, I have just included a motion. I want the resampling to be done to cover at least 5% of the copper connections. I understand that not so as not to affect structural safety, only the top and the back of the concrete will be opened up. I hope that you can have 1,300 copper connections opened up. Now, unless you're saying that sampling will not just cover the horizontal couplers, but the vertical couplers as well. Now, if you are in the fourth level, will you cut open the concrete and the couplers? And if you're looking at the nine coupler connections on top, that's fine. If you are doing that in on a three-dimensional basis, that is better. All right, because your explanation is so muddled and the experts are not here. And I hope that partial commissioning can be done in by the middle of next year, all the way to Diamond Hill. Now, as shown in this plan, I think Kitech is possible. I want you to cover Home and Teen Station as well, so that passengers can transfer to the Chun Wan line. That means both tracks are dual weights should be commissioned. I think this is feasible. Now, if both tracks are used, then the traveling time will be 10 minutes. Will you do that? Because of your poor monitoring of latent works, will you promise to do this? Yes. Thank you. Now we have to open up the Hong Ham Station platform slab. If need be, we may go as deep as 500 and 600 millimeters. That is as deep as 2 feet. And for the two rebars below and nine rebars above, yes, they will all be exposed. We can't cover too many, because we are worried that the structure will be jeopardized. Yes, all options will be considered, because Mr. Tian was so specific. Now, after Diamond Hill Station, now it is possible to go to Tun to Home and Teen, but if you want single track dual way, we have technical difficulties.
But we do not rule out all possibilities. We'll consider that, but we have to ensure that everything is safe before we do this. Mr. Lam Cheuk-ting, Chairman, the Secretary said that there are three stages for checking the concrete. First, MTLCO to check the records. Second phase, MTLCO to check the quality works. And then the third phase, MTLC to conduct the analysis or structural assessment. The whole thing is that the MTLC's records are incomplete. They even falsify the records. They hide things from the government. In the commission of inquiries, there are contradicting evidence. Finally, you can see that the highest level of the MTLCO have to resign as far as those are responsible works concerned. They may face civil claims. Their staff may face criminal liability. In view of the poor credibility record of the MTLCO, why, Mr. Secretary, you think that the MTLC should lead the three stages of investigation, from taking samples to conducting structural assessments? Why do you think this is appropriate for the MTLC itself to do so? shouldn't this be done by an independent third party, at least for the structural assessment? This is to ensure that the MTRC cannot interfere with the test results. This or investigation results. This affects the whole integrity and safety of the station. Thank you, Chairman. Thank you, Mr. Lam, for your concern. With regard to the holistic proposal, we are involved in drawing up this, and whatever level of work they do, our experts will follow that up. Maybe the Director of Highways can supplement on the details. In the three phases, the government will be fully involved. In the first phase, the MTRCL will check the records and drawings, but we also vet those drawings and records to see whether this is reliable. The information that is uncertain will be open up for checking, and then even the records we will also check. What about the third stage structural assessment? The buildings department will vet whether the drawings and also the results are safe. Why it can't be a third party, independent third party? Ms. Hon LUK Chung-hung, Chairman, three things. First, on Hong Kong Station, we are only looking at a small area of the problem. Hong Kong Station is under the building ordinance. Because it's built by the MTRCL, but other stations are not under the building's ordinance because they are built by the government. So we need to adopt the same standard. What about other stations apart from Hong Kong Station? How can you make sure that they are safe? Those stations are not under the building's ordinance. As for safety, this is our primary concern. We know that people want the SEL to commence operation ASAP, but safeties should come first. Now you take samples on the steel bars and also couplers. I hope that you should raise your safety coefficient. Similarly, you to check the details, even by picking out a steel bar. Now the platform is as long as 400 meters, and there are four levels. The total length is 4,000 meters. I think you should increase the number of openings for checking. As for couplers, you are not able to fulfill with the statistical requirements. I hope more spots can be opened up. As for partial commencement, I hope you will open the line for service on a partial basis. With regard to supervision on construction, the buildings department and the highways department are responsible. The Director of Highways can speak on the government works. So sampling and partial commencement, Dr. Kam will speak on this. With regard to sampling arrangement, it is an internationally recognized standard and has been applied widely, is objective and scientific and reasonable. I'm sorry, Dr. Kam, the question has been answered, but we don't need to belabor the point. I'd like to remind members, if you want to obtain an answer from the Bureau or from the MTRC, please be concise in asking your questions. Next, Ms. Liu Siwing. My question is on Convention Station. 66% of the works completed is less than the overall progress of 87%. The situation is not desirable. Explanation is given. Works are complicated, and there are unforeseen conditions, including the geotechnical conditions. What is the major reason for such a delay in progress. According to your rate of progress, you can only start operation in 2021. Will the convention station delay the date of commencement further? Mr. Chow, concerning the progress of convention station, we had some hiccups early this year. We discovered two bombs, and therefore we have to handle that. We have not fully exhausted the area that is affected by that was affected by bombs, and therefore we need to proceed very carefully. And there was also there is also the issue of settlement, and we have to conduct the assessment as well. As for the commencement of North-South Corridor, we are now reviewing the overall excavation and work situation and work of the exhibition station, a convention station, and we hope that we can catch up. And we are also reviewing the works arrangement for SCL so as to catch up with the timetable. Can you be more definite with the progress? As for the North-South line, the commencement to a certain extent is related to the East-West corridor. We only can make arrangements after the commencement of East-West corridor. So we do need to make an assessment in due course. Mr. Lau Kok-wan, settlement has caused some impacts on the buildings in Tokawan. I want to know the compensation arrangements. Up till now, no details have been provided. And we know that we don't even know when the Hong Kong station can be completed. And many residents are being affected. When the SCL is partly open to the public, can that be extended to Ho Man Tin Station? Now, if Hong Kong Station is not completed, you can't have the cross-harbour link. Now, with the opening of the SCL, there will be a change from 12 car train to a 9 car train. That's not acceptable. Will you consider a dual approach? Some trains have 12 cars and some trains have 9 cars. Can that be possible? MTRCL. First, concerning compensation because of rail works, there are legal provisions. We have given an undertaking to the LegCo, and that is a kind of community support, and we have a program, and we are ready for that, and we'll report to you, and we will start our registration in January. Do you have the details? Well, we will soon announce that in the district. Can you provide us with information now? Yes, we can. Thank you, Chairman. Now, concerning the information referred to by Dr. Kam, we have just appointed a consultant, a survey firm to deal with this package. We are now considering the details, and we will soon report to you the details. Other questions then? There are several questions. 9-car train is a necessity for the North-South corridor. We hope that we can minimize the impact on the East Rail. We have to wait for the commencement of part of the East-West corridor before we can do the 12-car to 9-car conversion. You have not answered my question. on using both 12-car trains and 9-car trains. Mr. Chairman, concerning the number of openings, I want to know more. We have to consider whether this is adequate. There are different views. I hope the MTRCL can explain it more with more detail so that people have confidence. I also hope to know about the financial situation of the SCL. The administration said that supplementary funding would be required. So when will you come before us for supplementary funding, and how soon will your funds be exhausted? Thank you, Chairman. Concerning the use of the funds, you can refer to the MTRCL paper. The overall rate of completion is 87%, and the fund usage is also to that extent. As to when the funds will be exhausted, it really depends on the progress of works. The remaining works will still use the money, so if the progress is faster, the funds will be used faster. Whether it's the North-South Corridor or East-West Corridor, there are still problems to be resolved. The MTRCL is still studying the use of funds. When we will come back for more money? In December 2017, the MTRCL had already asked for an additional $16.5 billion. That's the estimate of the MTRCL. But we have to consider each item, and each item has to be backed by adequate data and justification. But if they don't have enough money and the MTRCL has to pay in advance, can we agree? Do we have to agree to that? The payment in advance by MTRCL refers to the inspection in Hong Kong Station.
For other project costs, we'll pay according to the entrustment agreement. What is the cash flow available from the MTRCL? Please give us a paper later. Mr. Pun Xiuping, it is disappointing that the SCL has suffered project cost overrun and delay. And we'd like to know whether the MTRCL or the government is going to foot the bill when it comes to cost overrun. We understand that for Taiwai to Hong Kong, 99% of the projects are completed. So the government asks the MTRCL to study whether a partial opening is possible. Do you have any deadline for the study? And secondly, we understand that for the Israel, if the platform screen doors are only built after SCL is all completed, I'd like to know whether you really have to do that after the commissioning of SCL. If yes, how long is that going to take? Two questions. Frankly speaking, we hope the assessment of whether partial opening is possible can be done as soon as possible. But we really want to ensure safety. So rest assured, Mr. Poon, we will press ahead of full steam. But is there a deadline? End of this year, early next year? Well, we will do so as far as is practicable and safe. So our target is really to complete the assessment ASAP. And as for the platform screen doors for SCL, I defer to Dr. Kam. We don't have to wait until end SLS are fully commissioned before the platform screen doors can be done. We have to change from 12 car to 9 car trains first. Now, signaling and also consolidation of the platforms, maybe that's not obvious to users, but they're already completed. After we have completed the signaling, we will install the platform screen doors. Our current is 1 year for the construction, so 1 year afterwards. No. After all the trains have been converted to 9 car, then we will start works, and the project time will take 1 year. Dr. Anna Wong, what about the settlement data of Tokwa 1 station? You have given us the data. What about the data for tilting of the buildings? It's already a few months and you have not given us any data yet. So I hope the MTLCL and also the government can give us the information. And the safety test will be on Hong Kong Station. What about Tokwa 1 Station? Will there be any test to verify the structural safety and integrity? Because we understand that part of the rebars have been cut, and we are worried about the structural safety as well. So are you going to cover Tokwa 1 Station too? If not, why not? And for Hong Kong Station, I'd like to know whether all coupler connections will be included. So are you going to conduct some random sampling, or will you cover all the coupler connections? And who will be the witnesses of the testing, and will the results be submitted to this subcommittee? Now, in fact, details can be found in CB4268-1819-01, and you can find the data on the tilting of buildings. And Secretary, for the remaining questions, please. Well, government officials will witness all the tests, and we will see, we'll also decide whether the test results are acceptable or not. For details, I defer to the MTLCL. Well, workmanship testing, we use a random sampling method. We will check 168 couplers. Using non-destructive means, we will check how far the rebar has been screwed into the coupler. How come so few? Since it is non-destructive in nature, you will not affect the structural safety. Why only 168? Because we have to open up the concrete. As mentioned by Mr. Michael Tian, if we cut deep into the slab, then the couplers will be affected. The question was already answered. Mr. Gary Fan, the cutting short of the rebar scandal was exposed in May, and then the New Democrats reported to the police in early June, and the Railways Division of Highways Department only later. And then on the 23rd of July, we asked for checking the couplers. Now, it's already in December. It's more than 4.5 months. And finally, they've agreed to cut open the concrete. All right, Secretary, you refuse to admit mistakes and you refuse to take remedy actions. All right, there are over 20,000 coupler connections, and you will only check 168 of them. And for the top, you are going to take some samples, and auto 7 to 8 in the lower section. Now, if you do that selectively, you cannot be scientific enough in taking random sampling to check the gravity of the event. So I want you to review your approach. First, for each bay, you should ensure that there are copper connections checked, and you should increase substantially from the 168 joint couplers. And then you should not just go to the first and two levels, you should go deeper before you can be more accurate and scientific in seeing and verifying the problems of the platform slabs. Secretary, thank you, Mr. Fan, for your questions. The government has said a number of times in the council that we do not rule the possibility of opening up the concrete for checking. However, there is a lot of preparatory work. First, we must have clear objectives and clear procedures and details of the tests. And we have to ensure that the findings will ensure structural and safety integrity. We will only cover the areas where there are obvious changes to the drawing or design. Mr. Alvin Yeung, when the Secretary replied to the question as to when the trains can be commissioned, he said that it would be as soon as possible, but safety must come first. We have heard this reply a number of times. I'd like to know whether you have given criteria to the MTRCL. When these criteria are fulfilled, then there must be opening of the stations. Have you given the criteria to MTRCL? Yes, we have demanded that the MTRCL start a study on partial opening of the line and to give us a reply ASAP. But it has been more than a month after we have heard of this. So have you demanded the MTRCL to give your reply within, say, 1 month, 2 months, or 3 months? Have you given them a deadline? Thank you. I understand that Mr. Yuan is concerned about partial opening, but there can be many variables, the start point and the end point, and whether that can be done throughout the alignment, and alterations required for partial opening, and also the cost and time required for a restatement afterwards. And there must be coordination with a land transport as well. So a lot of work has to be done. So as I said, we do not have a deadline per se, but our target is to complete the study ASAP. When we want to benefit as many residents as possible. Well, I cannot challenge your conditions. Yes, they are reasonable. But you said as soon as possible. But for us, that means we have to wait indefinitely because money has already been spent. And MTRCL told us that over 99% of the works have been completed. We have the trains and the stations, but we cannot use them. Now, I think it would be much better if you set a deadline for the MTRCL to reply. Well, many members are concerned about this. We will have another meeting in 2 months' time. I hope by then you will have more details for us. Allow me to say a few more words. We have the holistic proposal. It takes about 10 weeks to complete. If no abnormality is found in the process, then perhaps the whole line can be opened. So we have a dual-pronged approach. If in 2 months' time you are still conducting that test, we are doomed. All right, you are going to sample 168 coupler connections. Assuming that they are all problematic, what are you going to do about them? Dr. Kim. We have a very solid mathematical foundation for assembling and analysis. We can calculate the impact on or the significance of the findings on the whole population. So we have to wait until stage three for structural assessment before we can confirm. I think you're just reading your line to tick. I'm saying that assuming that all 168 connections have failed, what will be the result? We have to wait until the structural assessment at stage three is done yet already. Now, we have to look at the remedial works required or extra works required. Well, for the sake of time, if all connections have failed, will you open up more locations? If many of them are problematic, will you open up more locations? Statistically, it's possible for us to collect more samples. What is the worst case scenario? If we open up more locations, there may be structural hazards. All right, I'm asking you, in the worst case scenario, when all locations are defective, what will you do? But this assumption is not necessarily reasonable. But you have to be prepared for the worst. Is that the contingency or crisis management of the MTRCL? But our approach is reasonable and scientific. I'm not saying that you're unreasonable. I'm asking you, if you encounter the worst case scenario, what will be the end game? Now, if all the locations are okay, please do not talk nonsense. You're wasting my time. I'm asking you about the worst case scenario. Don't talk about the best case scenario. Will you have to demolish the whole platform? I am saying that there can be many possibilities. Dr. Zhang Chongtai, well, you're going to open up the slab to check whether it is safe or not. And Mr. Jeremy Tam's question is, what are the indicators or under what circumstances will you decide that you have to open up more locations? And in the worst case scenario, will you have to demolish the whole platform slab? I think the question is very straightforward. What is your purpose of opening up the connections? Now, if you say that it's just to address concerns of the public on the safety of the platform, well, this is not what we want. We want to ensure or to verify whether the platform is safe or not. All right, let's set aside the number of samples. Now, do you have any assumptions on what to expect after the opening? And can you tell us the solutions or the how the way to respond in different scenarios? Secretary, we talked about three stages. Stage two, after we have conducted the non-destructive tests, if the situation is deemed undesirable, there are other considerations, for instance, to consolidation, to enhance the structure and integrity. I know Mr. Tam is concerned about safety. He said, what will we do in the worst case scenario? That means it is really undesirable, and I don't want to engage in any speculation. And if the situation is not very desirable, we have to consider consolidation. I think Dr. Kam from MTRCL wants to supplement. Yes. Let's set aside the random sampling. Let's talk about the structure. When there are problems with the structure, there can be a lot of ways to handle it. It can be by means of alteration or consolidation, and there are a number of options. We have to hand over the venue to the next meeting. We've got four options. For the next meeting, the first item is SCL as well. So why don't we receive the progress update on SCL first before we ask these members whether they want to proceed with their motions, okay? Speaker is off mic. speakers off mic. But the test will take 16 weeks. I hope the administration can pay heed to our views. I hope they can take on board our views on their methodology. I hope they can take on board our views, because come the next meeting, they might have already started the test, and by the time it's too late to accept our recommendations. This is not desirable, but I'm afraid time is up for the meeting. I can only urge the administration to consider views expressed by members, and please explain your holistic proposal in greater details. Meeting is adjourned.